In C# and .NET programming course, we are currently discussing the fifth module. We have completed what is the architecture of .NET framework. We have seen what is an attribute. What do you mean by a reflection? In this video, we are going to discuss what is an assembly. In the .NET architecture, the CLR execution model follows this steps. This is the model of common language runtime environment in which the source code can be of any language like Visual Basic, C# or C++, and these source code will be compiled by a .NET compliant compiler or .NET compatible compiler. And this compiler will be generating a code, object code, which is the intermediate language code, or you call it as Microsoft intermediate language code, which is nothing but the assembly. Now, the assembly is the one which will be given to the common language runtime for the execution. So we have to understand what will be the content of this particular assembly. Now, when you see an assembly, assemblies form the fundamental unit of deployment, version control, reuse, activation scoping, and security permissions for the .NET based application. So, this is going to be a collection of some components which can be used for the deployment, or can be used for versioning, or it can be used for activation, or it can also be used for some kind of security permissions. Now, these assemblies will take any of these two forms. It can be a .exe file, which is an executable file, or it can be a dynamic linking library file, which you call as .dll file. So, these are the two files which becomes the building blocks of the .NET framework. And these assemblies provide the common language runtime with the information which is to be required for the execution. So, what are the information that are to be aware for the execution by the common language runtime will be available in the assembly. So, the assembly can be called as a collection of the types and resources that form logical unit of functionality that are built to work together. So, if you want an application to be executed, you may be in need of different kinds of data types, different kinds of data structures, different kinds of forms, different kinds of functions, different kinds of resources. So, all these things collected together can be called as an assembly. So, in general, assembly is a logical collection of smallest unit in .NET framework, something like this .dll file that contains the application code, or the .aspx file that contains the execution code, and you have .ascx file which contains all the user controls, or you may be having some kind of image files or any kind of resources. All these things collected together will be called as an assembly. So, assemblies are the basic fundamental unit of application deployment as well as the development. So, whatever resources or the files that you are going to use for developing the application and for deploying the application becomes the assembly. So, the assembly contains the Microsoft Intermediate Language Code, which will be the platform independent code that you call as the CLR execution code, and all the data types, metadata will also be available, type metadata, the information about the types that you are going to use in the assembly. And it also contains an assembly manifest which contains the assembly metadata. So, type metadata is different, assembly metadata is different. The assembly metadata contains the information about what is the version of the assembly, what is the security identity you are going to give, what are the resources required by the assembly, what is the scope of the assembly. These kind of information will be available in the assembly manifest. The assemblies, apart from all these kind of information, it also provides security boundaries within the .NET framework. Something like the permission required by the application is specified while building the assemblies. And when the assembly is loaded into the runtime, the assembly sends the request to the runtime to grant the permission. So all the security permission will also be available inside the assembly. It will be given to the CLR when it is getting loaded, and the request will be given to the CLR, and the CLR will grant the permission according to the security specifications given inside the assembly. When you take the .NET assembly, it is the standard for components developed within the Microsoft .NET environment, and the .NET assembly may be an executable one or it may not be an executable one. So if it is going to be an executable one, it has the extension .exe, and if it is not executable but if it is a library component, it has the extension .dll. And all the .NET assemblies contain the definition of types, versioning information, metadata, as well as the manifest. So the assembly contains these kinds of information: a manifest, metadata, and the executable code or the object code. We can call it as object code, or you can call it as an intermediate language code, and all the resources, something like the main or the Windows main, or any other, if it is console based application, the main function of the console based application, all these kind of resources will also be available in an assembly. So let us see what is an assembly manifest. The assembly manifest will contain the metadata for the assembly, and the assembly manifest contain the information, something like what is the name of the assembly, what is the version of the assembly, what are the different resources that are made up for the assembly, and it will also have the permissions required for the assembly to run properly, and it will contain other details depending on the assembly. Sometimes your assembly may be a shared assembly, sometimes your assembly may be a private assembly. Those kind of information will also be available. Something like what is the type of the assembly will also be available in the assembly manifest. So when the common language runtime is loading the assembly, it will first read the manifest to get the information about the assembly. Only then the assembly gets executed in the common language runtime. And it depends completely on what kind of permissions you have set, what are the other details depending on that particular assembly. Based on that, the CLR will execute the assembly. Now, when you take the assemblies are generally stored in the programmable executable format or process executable format. The common file format is the .exe file, and it contains three sections. One will be the process executable header, and it will have the execute intermediate language code, and it will also contain the type metadata, right? So any .exe file will contain three sections: the header, the executable header, the process executable or program executable header, then the code, the object code, or you call it as the platform independent code, then all the metadata. These are the three things that will be available in the .exe file. Now, when you take the assemblies, these are some of the benefits of the assembly. Why we need to create an assembly? One, if you want to have versioning. Versioning means, say for example, you create one application and you are building that particular application. So you will have one .exe file, or you may be having a .dll file. Now, after creating that particular assembly, you may be adding another feature to that particular application. Now again you will be building the application. By the time, if you want to maintain the earlier build, what you can do, you can give different version number for these assemblies. That is what you call as version. So before adding the new feature, it may be version 1. After adding the new feature, the assembly will be version number something like 1.1. So the first version will be running without the new feature, and the second version will be running with the new feature added to the application. So for the same application, depending on the kind of features that you are going to add, you can give different version number. So same application with different versions can also be run in the common language runtime. Then for different type identification, I can use the assembly, and especially for the security reasons, what kind of permissions you are going to use and who can execute and where it can be executed, in what kind of environment you can execute, whether it can be executed remotely or whether it can be executed only in the local environment. All these kind of things can be specified in the security permissions. Then for deployment, so once you are ready with the web server application, that can be deployed. So for deploying also, all these information is required. Then for referencing, if it is going to be a library component and you want to refer it in your application, then also you can use the assemblies. And if you want to improve the performance, see, sometimes when you are adding different features, some of the features may not be working in a particular environment. So by the time, those features can be discarded and the earlier version can be executed in your local machine. Thereby you improve the performance of the application. So those kind of things can also be done using the assembly. And obviously for the code management and maintenance, we can make use of the assembly. So these are the different benefits, we can say, or advantages of the assemblies. You can have it as the versioning application or for identifying different data types and for the security permissions, and especially for the deployment and code management. And if you want to improve the performance of the application, in all those cases I can make use of the assemblies. Now when you take an assembly, these are the different types of assemblies in the .NET environment. You can have a static or dynamic assembly, you can have single file or multi-file assembly, you can have private or shared assembly, or satellite or resource only assemblies. These are the different types of assemblies. The static assemblies are the one which will be created when you compile the program using the .NET language compiler, or you call it as .NET compatible compiler. So whatever compiler you are going to use, based on that compiler you create an intermediate code, assembly code, that is what you call as the static assembly. And this contains all the type information and all the kind of interfaces that you are going to use and different resources that will be required by the assembly. And the static assembly will be generally stored in the hard disk in your local machine in the form of portable executable. So the PE can also be called as portable executable, or it is called as process executable format. Portable executable format, or it is called as process executable format, which will be .exe or .dll file. So any .exe or .dll file which you are going to store in your local machine is what you call as the static assembly, because that cannot be modified later. Whereas in the dynamic assembly, on the fly, if you are going to create this assembly and execute it, then you call it as dynamic assembly. So you can create the dynamic assembly through the namespace called as .emit namespace, which is available in the reflection. We have seen in the reflection, we can have the reflection object for an assembly also. So by the time what you do, as you access a constructor information or a member information, you can also access the assembly information. So by the time you access a particular type of the assembly, then you are going to create a new assembly from that particular type information, which is what you call as dynamic creation of the assembly. So you import a type of the assembly and you create an object of that particular assembly in your program dynamically, then you call it as dynamic assembly. So that can be done using the emit namespace. Then you have another assembly called a single file assembly. So if your assembly is containing only one.exe file or only one.ell file, then you call it a single file assembly. Whereas if you have multiple files, then you call it as multi-file assembly, or it is also known as multi-module assembly. This multi-file assembly is an assembly that contains that can include multiple files, but it must contain at least one.dll file or one.exe file. It can have, say for example, your multi-file assembly may contain one.exe file and it may contain more than one.dll file, or it may be containing more than one.dll file if everything is going to be a library component, right? That is what you call as multi-file assembly. So the assembly manifest in the multi-file assembly can be attached to any assembly file. So if you are going to have more number of .dll file and .exe file, the manifest information will be stored in any one of these files, and that can be created separately, just the manifest. Or it can be created separately, just the manifest. So what happens in the single file assembly, the manifest will be available inside this .exe or .dll file. But in the multi-file assembly, in any one of the, because you may be having more than one.exe file, more than one.dll file. So in any one of the file, you can attach the manifest, or you can have the manifest as a separate file. That is also allowed in the multi-file assembly. Then you have resource only or satellite assembly. The resource only assemblies are the assemblies that contains only the resources. There is no executable code, there is no .dll code. You have only the resources available. So when I say resources, maybe your database connection may be one of the resource, or database servers, database components can be one of the resources, or the different images that you are going to use can be called as one of the resources. So these kind of resources will be stored, but it will not contain any executable code or a .dll code. Then you call it as resource only assembly. And in the resource only assembly, if you have culture specific information, culture specific information is nothing but the country information, the region information, or the language information, or the time zone information. If you include all these kind of information in the resource only assembly, then the assembly becomes the satellite assembly. That is, you are going to specify the geographic information about that particular assembly, from where it has been created, in which time zone, in which country, in which region of the region. All these kind of information, if you store in the resource only assembly, then you are going to call it as satellite assembly. Then you have another assembly called as private assembly. So when you deploy an assembly which can be used by a single application, then the assembly is called as the private assembly. So you use this assembly by only one application. It can be used by only one application they are deployed with. Other applications cannot access these assemblies. So sometimes you are going to create a .dll file and this can be used by only one application at a time. Then you are going to call it as a private assembly. And these private assemblies are deployed in the directory where the main application is installed. And you have another assembly called as shared assembly. So when you deploy an assembly which can be used by several applications, when I say several applications, it can be non-related applications, then this kind of assembly is called as shared assembly. The shared assemblies will be generally stored in the global assembly cache. There is a folder called as global assembly cache, which is accessible by all the applications running in the CLR. So this is the location where all the shared assemblies will be stored. Now whenever you are going to have the shared assembly must have a strong name in the assembly. Now strong name means it must contain the assembly name, it must contain the version number, it must also contain the culture specific information, and it must contain the public key and also an optional digital signature. The private key will also be available in the shared assembly that contains the strong name. And the global assembly cache is the one which will be maintaining multiple copies of an assembly with the same name but with different version number. I have already told you, for you can create the same application with two different version numbers. If you have some kind of variations in the features, then you can create the application as two different versions. These two versions can be stored in the global assembly cache. So that means the cache can contain same assembly name provided the version numbers of these assemblies are different. That is also possible in the case of shared assembly. So the only thing that you have to understand here is it can be shared by more than one applications, and these applications need not be a related one, it can be a non-related application. So since you are going to share this assembly, you need some location to store this assembly so that all the applications are going to access them. How do you do that? You can make use of the global assembly cache folder in which I can store the shared assembly. And if you want to have it as a shared assembly, it must have a strong name. How do you specify a strong name? The assembly must contain the version number, all the culture specific information, and it must have a public key along with a private key, and it can also have a digital signature. So only then you can call it as a shared assembly. So these are the different types of assemblies available. Static assemblies will be created when you are going to compile using your .NET language compiler, and which will have portable executable in the form of .exe or .dll file. And the dynamic assembly, if you are going to use it as a reflection object, then you can create the assembly dynamically on the fly, then you call it as dynamic assembly. The single file assembly will contain only one .exe or .dll file, whereas if you have more than one .exe and more than one .dll file, then you call it as multi-file or multi-module assembly. And if you are going to have more number of .dll or more many .exe file, then the manifest information must be provided in any one of these .exe or .dll file, or you can specify it as a separate file in the multi-file assembly. Then the resource-only assembly will not contain any code, executable code or a DLL code will not be available. It contains only the resources, something like images or the database connectivity, all those kind of resources will be available. And to these resources, I mean, along with the resources, if you are going to provide some culture specific information, then it becomes the satellite assembly. Then if an assembly is used by only one application, then you are going to call it as a private assembly, and it will be deployed in the main application directory itself. Whereas if the assembly can be shared by more than one application, then it is called as shared assembly, and it needs to be stored in the global assembly cache folder so that all the applications can access it. And the only thing is, if it is to be a shared assembly, it must have a strong name, and it can also have the same assembly, if you are going to have more than one assemblies with the same name, the only condition is it must have different version number. So these are the different kinds of assemblies we can have. So in general, you can say assembly is the one which is the managed code along with the intermediate language code. It contains the metadata information about the code, and it will also contain the metadata about the assembly. Now, when I say metadata about the assembly, it is the version number, security information, and all the kind of resources and what is the scope of that particular assembly. These kind of information will be stored in the assembly. So what happens? Whenever the assembly is given to the common language runtime, the common language runtime will load the assembly, then it will access all the metadata information, and depending on the security information and the details provided in the assembly, the CLR will decide how the assembly is to be executed and produce the output. That is how the assemblies are used in the CLR execution model. In the next video, we will be talking about what is versioning and how the version number is to be provided in the assembly.